Excellencies, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen, my name is Madeline Sinclair and I represent an NGO called the International Service for Human Rights, dedicated to supporting human rights defenders and strengthening human rights systems. I'd like to take just a very brief opportunity to welcome you here this morning to our Human Rights Council pledging event, which we are holding ahead of the Human Rights Council elections this fall. We, along with our colleagues from Amnesty International, are delighted to be organizing this event for what is now the fourth year running. As you are all no doubt aware, the success of the Human Rights Council's important work very much depends on it being composed of members who, to quote General Assembly Resolution 6251, uphold the highest standards in the promotion and protection of human rights. In that regard, when electing members to the Council, that same resolution directs member states here in New York to take into account the contribution of candidates to the promotion and protection of human rights and their voluntary pledges and commitments made thereto. In effect, today's event is an opportunity for candidates to address how they plan to take on the important work and responsibilities they will face if elected as members of the Human Rights Council in Geneva. It is in that spirit that some candidates have gathered here today to respond to a few questions on how they plan to realize the pledges and commitments they have made in seeking election, and we really want to acknowledge the willingness of those participating to do so. Without further ado, and in the spirit of keeping everything very strict time limits this morning, I'd like to pass it on to my colleague from Amnesty International to say a few more words of welcome.
Thank you, Madeline. My name's Richard Bennett, and I'm representing Amnesty International. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, in organizing this event, we extended invitations to all candidates and wish to sincerely thank those of you who accepted our invitation. We're very pleased to see states representing four different regional groups at this event. We welcome the readiness of candidates to engage in this discussion and their commitment to transparency in the election process. We encourage all future candidates to join us at next year's event. We sincerely appreciate the support of the permanent missions of Botswana, Brazil, and the Netherlands for the event this year. We're happy to see you represented here today at senior level, which demonstrates the importance you accord to this event and to the work of the Human Rights Council. We're also very grateful for the support by OHCHR to this event over the years. We are pleased that our moderator today is Charles Radcliffe, who's the chief of the Global Issues Section and officer in charge of the New York office of OHCHR. Mr. Radcliffe, may I now hand over to you and invite you to moderate this event.
Thank you, Mr. Bennett, Richard. And thank you to the organizers of today's event. Excellencies, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen, in countries around the world, public meetings like this are a fixture of elections. There's a chance for voters to hear from the candidates, to better understand the motivation of those who are seeking office, and to examine the pledges and the promises that they've made. Now, as we know, when it comes to the UN Human Rights Council, the electoral process isn't always as competitive as we might like. The number of countries that present themselves for membership from each region typically matches the number of open slots that are reserved for each region. But that, I think, only makes it all the more important that we have opportunities, like the one that we have here today, to question candidates on their commitment to human rights and to examine the specific pledges that they've made as part of their application to join what is, after all, the world's peak intergovernmental body on human rights. Now, over the course of the next couple of hours, we'll have a chance to hear from and put questions to eight of the countries that are seeking a place on the Human Rights Council starting next year. I'd like to warmly thank those eight countries for agreeing to put themselves through this process and for approaching this exercise in a spirit of candor and accountability. And I'd like to thank everyone else for being here today, for being part of this, and welcome also those who aren't with us but who are following our discussion via webcast and on Twitter. Now, a brief word on the format of today's event. Candidates are going to be first asked to give a brief presentation in answer to a general question which they have received in advance. We will then open the floor to questions from the audience. So please start thinking now about the questions you'd like to ask. And if you're watching from home, You can tweet your question to us, to the candidates, using the hashtag HRCpledging. We'll be monitoring the Twitter feed, and we'll be putting some of these tweeted questions to candidates in the course of this morning's discussion. Now, before we get to question time, I'd like to invite our co-hosts, the distinguished representatives of Botswana, Brazil, and the Netherlands, to make some brief opening remarks, starting with Ambassador Nicolai, the Deputy Permanent Representative of Botswana. You have the floor.
Thank you, Amnesty International, and International Service for Human Rights for organizing this event. We express our delight at participating at this event, and we equally share our gratitude with the governments of the Netherlands and the government of the Federative Republic of Brazil for co-hosting this event. As you know, Botswana's unwavering commitment to the effective promotion and protection of human rights is fundamental, and this is contained in its constitution. Having been re-elected to the Council to the Human Rights last year, we continue to fully support the work of the Council and to be effectively engaged in its activities. We recognize that the Human Rights Council is a UN body created by member states to serve the best of humanity, and that its strong membership is very key to the success in this regard. Botswana therefore welcomes this initiative by the organizers to create an opportunity for countries to share their aspirations and vision for the membership of the Human Rights Council. This should go a long way to a stronger, transparent, and more effective Human Rights Council. I thank you.
Thank you very much, Ambassador. We go to Ambassador Patriota, the Permanent Representative of Brazil.
Thank you very much. And like my colleague from Botswana, let me also thank Amnesty International and the International Service for Human Rights for convening this exercise. And let me congratulate the candidates to the Human Rights Council for the 2016-2018 term who have agreed to take part in this exercise today, with a view to sharing their priorities and commitments to the promotion and protection of human rights with other member states, UN agencies, and civil society. I also take this opportunity to underscore the importance that all UN member states engage constructively in support of the activities of the Human Rights Council, whether through presenting their candidacies for membership, participating in the Universal Periodic Review Mechanism, extending invitations to mandate holders for this, of the special procedures, and of course endorsing and implementing recommendations. Brazil is of the view that the Human Rights Council has contributed to strengthening the international regime of human rights in a non-selective and universal manner. And indeed, as former High Commissioner for Human Rights Mary Robinson acknowledged, Brazil is a good example of a country that has taken advantage of the multilateral participation in fora such as the Human Rights Council in order to enact domestic reforms that enhance its ability to protect and promote human rights. Our role as member states is to continue showing support for the Council so that it can effectively discharge a statutory responsibility of promoting universal respect and protection of all human rights and fundamental freedoms for all. So I'm very pleased to be here with colleagues from Botswana and the Netherlands this morning. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ambassador. And now to Ambassador Van Ostrom from the Netherlands.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. My full statement will be available through my Twitter account. Just a few remarks. First, thanks very much for the co-organizing from this wonderful event. Last year we participated here in this grueling exercise, so I wish strength to the colleagues here behind the table. In the Netherlands we have a saying, for those of you who speak Dutch, mensenrechten zijn van iedereen, human rights are owned by everybody, and that's why we welcome the fact there's so many various people in this audience. I see people from NGOs, I see member states, I see the UN system, I see civic society, and through webcast it's very good to see that there's a lot of people citizens. Very often for us here in the UN, human rights are abstract concepts, but by having this dialogue, this interaction, we try to make human rights a reality. I would like to quote Irene Kahn, a former Secretary General of Amnesty International, who once said, "Human rights are the basis for creating strong and accountable states, without which there can be no political stability or social progress." And to achieve that accountability, to achieve the improvement of human rights, this kind of interaction, this kind of dialogue between states, between the institutions in New York and Geneva, but particularly with civic society like today, that is what we aim to promote. And therefore, the Kingdom of the Netherlands is your partner for peace, justice and development, and human rights are integral to all those dimensions. We're very happy to co-sponsor this event. Thanks so much.
Thank you very much, Ambassador. You mentioned your statement is available on Twitter. As some may know, the Dutch ambassador is very big on Twitter. And I hope that we will all be big on Twitter today, because we are encouraging everybody, please, to tweet about the event and also to tweet in your questions if you're watching. Thank you. A brief word on the way that this is now going to unfold. We are going to begin our discussion with the candidates. Each candidate was sent the same question in preparation for the event. And we've asked each one to answer in no more than 3 minutes. We will then work our way in alphabetical order through the candidates. The question is the following. What mechanisms do you have or will you put in place at the national level to systematically follow up on the implementation of Human Rights Council resolutions, recommendations by the special rapporteurs and independent experts, and outcomes of the universal periodic review process? We're going to start in alphabetical order with Belgium. Let me point out that Belgium previously served on the Council, 2010 to 2012, and has ratified all but one of the core international human rights treaties. Mr. Ouvry, you have the floor.
Thank you very much, Chair, and thank you for this question, which rightly brings to our attention the necessity to put ever more emphasis on the implementation of our human rights obligations, which is a priority for Belgium. Let me first of all remind all present here today that Belgium issued a standing invitation for all special procedures of the Human Rights Council. In February 2015, we received the Special Rapporteur on Contemporary Forms of Slavery in Belgium. In October, we will welcome to Belgium the Working Group on Mercenaries. In our national UPR statement in the Council, in a systematic way, we call on member states who did not yet issue a standing invitation to emulate this good practice and to provide full cooperation to all special procedures. At the national level, we have a 6-monthly coordination exercise where we look into progress for all recommendations formulated by special procedures, the UPR, but also treaty bodies, which you didn't mention in your question, and the mechanisms of the Council of Europe, which is our regional human rights organization. Overall, after consolidation of all the material, we look into the implementation of almost 400 different recommendations. On each recommendation, we identify concerned ministries, administrations, and organizations, both at a political and an administrative level. We then agree on the administration or organization in charge of coordination of this recommendation and follow up and monitor progress. We have also recently decided to share this overview of recommendations with our civil society, which is a transparency measure which will enhance our dialogue with civil society. Let me mention then two specific challenging issues. First one is the fact that we receive a high number of recommendations on racial discrimination and other forms of discrimination, including multiple forms of discrimination. The most important instrument in the fight against racism and other forms of discrimination for Belgium is the independent Interfederal Centre for Equal Opportunities. Last year, the centre considered more than 4,000 cases. Almost half of them were deemed credible and were followed up. Sometimes the intervention of the centre is limited to informing all involved about their rights and obligations. This may be then followed up with mediation. And if this mediation doesn't provide a solution, the matter may go to court. The number of reports is steadily increasing, which is at least partly due to the opening of local offices by the Centre for Equal Opportunity throughout the country, throughout Belgium, which lowers the threshold for people to introduce their case in order to find a remedy. Then, in order to conclude on a last specific issue, let me mention a coordinated initiative which was taken recently to enhance coherent prosecution of discrimination and hate crimes through sensitization of the relevant bodies. both judges and police and social inspection services receive training. Courts, police services also receive reference staff, which are specifically qualified in matters of discrimination. And then thirdly, specific targets, specific statistics are then gathered in order to see how we proceed in terms of prosecution. This allows all actors involved to gain advanced knowledge and awareness of anti-discrimination legislation. We believe that this is a very effective tool to close the gap between the law and actual remedy to victims of discrimination, including racism. Thank you very much, Chair, and I look forward to hearing other questions.
Thanks to the distinguished delegate from Belgium. Next, we're going to hear from the Ambassador of Georgia. Georgia has ratified all but one of the core international human rights treaties. And if elected, this would be the first time that the country has served as a member of the Human Rights Council. Ambassador Imnadze, you have the floor.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. Given the time constraints, I'll cut to the bone right away. It's a well-known adage that, first of all, the human rights start at home. Therefore, the Georgian government actively continues its unbending path of reforms aimed at bolstering the rule of law, transparency, and accountability of government to better provide protection of human rights for its citizens. Widely considered as one of the most successful reformer countries of the last decade, Georgia has been recently ranked number 29th in the 2015 Rule of Law Index of the World Justice Report, which is the best in our region. In 2014, Georgia adopted the Comprehensive and Long-Term Human Rights Strategy for 2014-2020 and subsequent action plan for 2014-15 elaborated in a transparent manner and, most importantly, with active involvement of civil society international actors. Its effective implementation and monitoring is ensured by Human Rights Secretariat and the Human Rights Interagency Council, which is under the Prime Minister. Georgia also has a Class A national human rights institution, which is the Office of the Public Defender or the Ombudsman, along with Gender Equality Council, chaired by a Vice Speaker of the Parliament, and special positions were also established, such as the Human Rights Advisor to the President, Assistant to Prime Minister on Human Rights and Gender Equality Issues, and also Ambassador at Large on Human Rights within the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, who is tasked to systematically follow up on the implementation of HRC resolutions, recommendations by special rapporteurs and independent experts, and outcomes of the UPR process. Like Belgium, we also have open invitations since 2010 to all special mandate holders to visit Georgia, and many of them have already visited. In addition, the Permanent Interagency Working Group has been set up as the national coordination mechanism involving executive, judicial, and legislative branches of the government to promote the national reporting process and proper implementation of Georgia's obligations before various UN treaty bodies and conventions. In 2014, the CEDAW and Human Rights Committee considered state periodic reports of Georgia, while two other reports were submitted to CERD and CRC. As for the UPR, we do see it as a unique instrument to facilitate the promotion of human rights worldwide. Having undergone the first cycle in 2013, we voluntarily pledged and subsequently submitted a midterm report on the implementations of the recommendations in December 2014. And to give also a specific example, since 2012, Georgia undertook a set of institutional reforms in order to address international and national recommendations aimed at liberalizing the criminal justice sector in Georgia. Therefore, the rights of defendants were enhanced to ensure equality of arms in adversarial trial. The plea bargaining procedure became more transparent, and institutional independence of prosecutor service was also strengthened. I'll stop at that and will try to answer the question that comes after. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ambassador. We now move to Germany, which has twice before served on the Human Rights Council. Germany has ratified all but one of the core international treaties. Ambassador Toms, you have the floor.
Ladies and gentlemen, first of all, I would like to thank Amnesty International, Botswana, Brazil, and Netherlands for organizing today's panel. We highly value this opportunity to share our thoughts on the Human Rights Council, but even more importantly, this puts us, the candidates, to the test, and this is something we fully embrace. Over the past 10 years, the Human Rights Council has become the leading international institution concerned with human rights protection around the world. It is crucial that the discussion in the Council and its recommendations have a strong impact on the ground, and this leads me to today's question. The German government is fully aware that the protection and promotion of human rights must begin in one's own country. It is a task which we have to tackle anew every day, and we have to allow ourselves to be judged by how well we do it. We are therefore grateful to have a very active, independent National Institute for Human Rights, which monitors the human rights activities of the German government closely and critically. And of course, NGOs also play a key monitoring role. In Germany, we have a very vibrant NGO scene whose expertise and recommendations are highly valued by the German government. I would also like to recall that we have a standing invitation to all special procedures, regardless of their mandate. But how does the implementation of the UPR and other recommendations by the Council's special procedures in Germany work? Please allow me to go into some bureaucratic details now. In Germany, the line ministries are responsible for implementing the provisions of the treaties and the rights enshrined therein. This mainly concerns the Ministry of Justice and the Ministry of the Interior, but also includes the Ministries of Labour and Social Affairs, Family Affairs, Senior Citizens, Women and Youth, and others. In turn, the federal structure of our country is such that the federal state also carries responsibility for implementing our international obligations in many instances. Since human rights are a cross-cutting issue, there is a constant exchange between the various levels and branches of government. This ensures that positions taken in multilateral fora reflect the common position of all those involved and that obligations are known to all relevant actors. This process of interagency coordination also applies when fulfilling our reporting obligations, to which we attach great importance. This includes requests for follow-up and implementing accepted UPR recommendations. Cooperation with the UN treaty bodies is very important to us. We engage actively in the reporting process and pay close attention to the recommendations received from treaty bodies. This is especially true when the same conclusion is reached by other institutions, like, for example, the Council of Europe. One recent example is training for those who care for victims of torture arriving in Germany as fugitives or asylum seekers, a very important issue given the current international situation. The Manual on Effective Investigation and Documentation of Torture and Other Cruel, Inhumane or Degrading Treatment or Punishment had only been available in English for some time. The German government has taken the initiative to provide all relevant bodies with free online access to a German translation, at the same time promoting its use in all relevant training institutions. And finally, aside from regularly reporting to the treaty bodies, the federal government publishes a biannual report on its human rights policy at the request of our federal parliament. This report extensively covers relevant developments at the national level, as well as human rights in our foreign and development policy. It also comprises an action plan for the subsequent two-year period, and thus not only provides a basis for assessing the implementation of our human rights policy in the past, but also outlines clear commitments for the future. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ambassador. Next is Kyrgyzstan, which is seeking a seat on the Council for the second time, having served in 2010 to 2012. Kyrgyzstan has ratified all but two of the core international human rights treaties. Ambassador Kidirov, you have the floor.
First of all, I would like to thank the organizers for this very important event, and we are participating for the first time, and it's, I think, very useful for Kyrgyzstan and other countries. The new constitution adopted in 2010 affirms the principle of the rule of law, guarantees the separation of powers, the independence of courts, as well as protection of human rights. In accordance with Article 2 of the Constitution, human rights and freedoms are of the supreme value. Kyrgyzstan today is strongly committed to implement its international obligations and participate in the activities of Human Rights Council. We have signed 8 of 9 main UN conventions on human rights, passed through 2 UPRs, the first review in 2010, when we accepted 154 recommendations out of 168, the second in January this year, when we had accepted 70% out of 196 recommendations. In 2012-2015, Kyrgyzstan presented 8 national reports on human rights and more than 25 since gaining independence. During the last years, our country has been visited by 8 special rapporteurs. Today, Kyrgyzstan is gradually establishing the appropriate mechanisms in order to effectively implement the international standards and recommendations on human rights. In particular, Kyrgyzstan has adopted a national strategy for sustainable development for 2013-17 which set the task to ensure the rule of law and human rights. In 2013, we have created Coordinating Council for Human Rights of the government, headed by the Vice Prime Minister. The Council is monitoring the respect for human rights, taking measures to implement the recommendations of the relevant international bodies. Today, the country has developed a very strong civil society. More than 10,000 non-governmental organizations have been officially registered, 80% of which are engaged in human rights activities. One of our concerns is the promoting gender equality and empowerment of women. In this regard, Kyrgyzstan has adopted the National Strategy for Gender Equality till 2020 and the action plan of its implementation. In 2012, the government established a National Council for Gender Development. Special measures have been taken to promote women's leadership. Today, a 20% quota for women was fixed in electoral law. Many key positions of power have been held by women. We had President, Attorney General, Chairman of Supreme Court, 3 Deputy Speakers, several ministers. I would like also to inform that the first woman military observer is approved recently to participate in UN peacekeeping operations. Fundamental role is playing the Parliament and the Institute of Ombudsman. In order to enhance the role of women, peace and security, National Plan of Action for Implementation of the Resolution 1325 of the Security Council was approved. Several programs have been adopted. For example, the program to combat human trafficking for 2013-16, a special joint program on acceleration of progress towards the economic empowerment of women. As the current plans, Kyrgyzstan has started to develop a national strategy on human rights for 2015-2019 and is conducting a preparatory work to incorporate SDGs into national strategies and programs. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ambassador. And now we go to Panama, which is presenting itself for membership to the Council for the first time. Panama has ratified all but one of the core international human rights treaties. Ambassador Morales Quijano, the floor is yours.
I thank the moderator, the Honorable Charles Ratcliffe, and the sponsors of this event, Botswana, the Netherlands, and Brazil, for the continuation of this very valuable initiative. Panama, as stated in document A/70/71, has a history of involvement in the human rights movement that dates back to 1948. Also in 2006-2007, the permanent representative of Panama, Ricardo Alberto Arias, served as co-chair of the meetings that led to the decision to create the HRC. We take much pride in these facts. Panama has re-emerged from 2 historic stages in which human rights were not an official priority, but this changed last year by force of the values and the reaction of our people and of the unquestionable commitment of our new government, of its legal institutions, and of all of civil society organizations. Among these, nearly a dozen entities exercise autonomous follow-up mechanisms that allow us to offer a clear yes to this year's amnesty question to participants. We have good mechanisms in place, several specializing in economic, social, political, and cultural rights in general. We are trying hard to set an example for other nations. In particular, I must mention the renewed power, authority, and processes of our ombudsman, the strict legislation enacted for, among countless areas, the prevention of violence against women and human trafficking, the protection of children, adolescents, and family, the welfare and human and economic development of our indigenous population, for the provision of healthy air, water, sanitation, food, medical facilities, and education, the fair treatment of undocumented residents, and the protection, of course, of the ecosystem. This last measure is critical to food security, human development, and general livelihood of mankind, and is part of our vision of a framework of individual and collective rights which we feel are interdependent, as we can observe in the Millennium Development Goals. Panama has created in a multi-stakeholder entity in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs the Empowered Permanent National Commission on Human Rights, which oversees and coordinates within the government all mechanisms related to human rights. Nonetheless, one specific issue of particular concern is the exposure to environmental hazards of improvised or poor quality human settlements spread out along suburban and rural areas. Aware of this situation, our government is investing billions of dollars in providing full sanitation, good quality homes and neighborhoods, basic services, and in reducing vulnerability to natural disasters. I thank you very much for your kind attention.
Thank you very much, Ambassador. And now to the Republic of Korea, which is seeking a fourth term on the Human Rights Council. The Republic of Korea has ratified all but two of the core international human rights treaties. Ambassador Yu, you have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I would first like to express my gratitude to Amnesty International and International Service for Human Rights, as well as three co-sponsoring countries for organizing this valuable and timely event. This is the first time for the Republic of Korea to attend this gathering, and I'm very much honored to be a part of it. I'm very keen to observe the rules of the game and the time limits, so I would like to start immediately by responding to the question of the day. Korean effort to maintain an effective framework to implement faithfully the recommendations and outcomes from the UPR, the International Human Rights Treaty Bodies, and the UN Special Procedures Center on the National Action Plan for the Promotion and Protection of Human Rights, which is NAPNAP, in place since May 2007, in accordance with the recommendation of the Vienna Declaration and Program of Action. This National Action Plan serves as a blueprint framework which aims to upgrade nationwide human rights-related regulations, policies, and practices. We are now implementing second NAP for the years 2012 and 16. In order to assist the drafting of NAP and to monitor its implementation more vigorously, we set up the National Human Rights Policy Council in 2008 as a mechanism for inter-ministerial consultations at the vice ministerial level. In formulating the NAP, relevant ministries are required to deliberate on the recommendations and outcomes of the UPR and human rights treaty bodies and to submit specific goals and detailed plans to implement them. And the National Human Rights Policy Council monitors their implementation on a regular basis. In addition, my government aims to make the process much more transparent, inclusive, and effective as follows. First, when an international human rights treaty body provides recommendations after its review of our national report, each relevant ministry is required to submit the plans to implement the recommendations. In this process, the ministries hold public hearings and consultations to reflect the voices of various stakeholders, including human rights NGOs and academia. Second, each ministry is called to report to the National Human Rights Policy Council the status of the previous year's implementation of recommendations, with the Ministry of Justice playing coordinating role. Third, my government launched the National Ombudsman Program in 2013, which allows the voice of the general public to be heard in the implementation process. By going through the above-mentioned process, we try honestly and vigorously to guarantee the relevance of the process, thus contributing to effective implementation of the recommendations from the UPR, human rights mechanisms and treaty bodies, and to raising awareness of the Korean public about them. To further enhance our cooperation with UN human rights mechanism, Korea has also extended a standing invitation to the UN special procedures. Since 2010, three special rapporteurs already visited Korea, and my government is currently coordinating with the OHCHR with regard to five more special procedures, special rapporteur or working groups planning to visit my country in the near future. Let me finish by sharing one issue of concern in my country, which is the human trafficking issue. As you may know, during the review of our CEDAW report in 2011 and our CLC report in 2011 also, and also our UPL process in 2012, we were advised to ratify the Palermo Protocol to the Convention Against Transnational Organized Crime. Subsequently, my government has had included the recommendation in its NAP goals and had examined the issue every year. A revised criminal code incorporating the definition of human trafficking set out in the protocol was passed by the National Assembly in 2013, and the ratification process with regard to TOC convention was finally completed May this year. So we will soon deposit our instrument of ratification. To conclude, my government, Korean government, remains strongly committed to the promotion and protection of human rights of every individual in my country through active implementation of recommendations by the international human rights mechanisms and treaty bodies. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you very much, Ambassador. We have two more countries to hear from in this first opening round of statements. And next is Slovenia, seeking a council seat for the second time. Slovenia has ratified all but two of the core international human rights treaties. Ambassador Mann, you have the floor.
Mr. Moderator, I would also like to thank the organizers and co-sponsors of today's event. Slovenia fully supports the work of the Human Rights Council and its mechanisms. We value their contribution to the protection and implementation of human rights worldwide. In Slovenia, the implementation of recommendations received by the international human rights mechanisms is monitored by the Interministerial Commission on Human Rights, a body composed of representatives from the Prime Minister's Office, all ministries, Office for National Minorities, representatives of civil society, non-governmental organizations, and of academia. It is further monitored by an independent national office of the Human Rights Ombudsperson, who issues the annual report on the state of play of human rights in the country. Slovenia has issued a standing invitation to all special procedures in 2001 and has accepted all requests for visits from special procedures since then. Most recent such visit took place in November 2014, when we welcomed the independent expert on the enjoyment of all human rights by older persons, Ms. Rosita Kornfeld-Mate, on her first country visit. We established close intra-ministerial cooperation and cooperation with NGOs in preparing her visit and look forward to analyzing her report and reviewing her recommendations. Slovenia further seeks to contribute to the work of the special procedures through responding to their questionnaires to the greater extent possible. Slovenia engages in interactive dialogues upon presentation of the reports and will continue to do so in the future. We find their recommendations valuable in terms of identifying pertinent human rights questions and solutions that might be most applicable to address them. The Universal Periodic Review is a unique mechanism on peer review that gives the international community the opportunity to work together to improve human rights situation worldwide. Slovenia underwent its second UPR in November 2014. The implementation of UPR recommendations, especially those with implications for our legislation, is ensured in the wider governmental coordination. The monitoring process of the implementation is led by the earlier mentioned Intra-Ministerial Commission on Human Rights, which also oversees the treaty bodies' reporting processes and the implementation of recommendations by Council of Europe. I thank you.
Thank you very much, Ambassador. And finally, we go to Switzerland, which of course provides a home for the Human Rights Council. Switzerland has ratified all but two of the core international human rights treaties and has previously served two earlier terms on the Council. Ambassador Seeger, you have the floor.
Well, thank you very much and good morning to everybody, and thanks to the organizers and also to the three co-sponsors for organizing that event. As you said, we have been on the Council several times before, and in fact in 2008 Switzerland has volunteered to be one of the first countries to undergo the UPR. And to prepare that report, actually, we had a broad national consultation process at the federal and at the cantonal levels. And it was a very inclusive and transparent process which involved entities of all levels of government, civil society, and academic institutions. In fact, we are now preparing the next report, and we will do that in the same fashion. Now, maybe just an element which may be known, but is important for the question of implementation, which you ask. As you know, we are a federal country of 26 cantons, and although the recommendations of the Human Rights Council are indeed addressed to Switzerland as a state, the responsibility quite often lies within these federal entities like the cantons and municipalities. So we have set up a interministerial working group which is in charge of coordinating the follow-up to the recommendations. And this working group aims at creating a transparent and inclusive process and is composed of different federal actors across various ministries, as well as of representatives of cantons and specific federal commissions. The idea is to share information on the implementation of the recommendations and define priorities and measures. We also organize conferences to allow for exchange of views with civil society, academic institutions, and interested parties, because it is important from our point of view to include very strongly civil society organizations. Now, as I said before, we are preparing the second UPR, and we try to do that in the same fashion, and the second UPR will take place in April 2017. Now, very briefly, on one issue, I would like to talk very openly concerning one recommendation which initially we refused, and that was recommendation to create an independent national human rights institution. We did, however, took a voluntary commitment to consider the establishment of such an institution, and we decided to accept a similar recommendation during our second UPR participation. Now, we have created, instead of a fully Paris-compatible institution, a Swiss Center of Expertise for Human Rights as a pilot project. And after external evaluation, we have decided now that this project will continue for another 5 years. Now, several ministries should now present various options to see whether or not such an institution will be created permanently. And that, I think, is what we are discussing right now. And I think, thanks also to the UPR implementation recommendations, we had such a discussion on the national level. I have to admit, though, that discussion was rather controversial, and it's still going on. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ambassador, and in fact, for all the representatives of our candidate countries, for your answers to our opening question. This concludes the first part of our discussion. We now move to the second part, where we will open the floor for questions from the audience. I would ask you please to be concise and, if possible, to come with questions rather than statements. We have only a fixed amount of time available, and we want to give as many delegates and members of the public as possible an opportunity to contribute. Questions may be of a general nature or directed at a specific candidate, and each candidate will have 2 minutes in which to answer your questions in this first round. So we'll open the floor now for questions before going back to the candidates. And I would ask you please to introduce yourself before asking your question. Thank you.
Thank you for giving me the floor. My name is Bina, and I come from India, from the Manipur Women Gun Survivors Network. I have just 3 questions. First is, how are the 8 countries and those who are asking for candidacy contribute for women human rights defenders? Because this resolution on women human rights defenders was passed in 2013. I myself, as a women human rights defender from India, when we faced threat last year, there was no one to help. No UN, no governments, no human rights organizations came out to really concretely have a device program. So how are the countries going to address this? Second, in today's world, everything works if it's reported by BBC or CNN, IBN, or CNN. There are so many forgotten conflict zones in the world. The place where I come from has 50,000 killed with the martial law called the Armed Forces Special Power Act, imposed in a corner of India, which is one of the world's largest democracies. Yet, government after government tells me that India is a powerful country, we cannot work on it. How are nations going to take some of these critical issues up? Because for women human rights defenders who are risking our lives, we will hold the UN accountable. We will hold you accountable for this. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next question, over there.
Turn on the mic. Thank you. Philippe Lepion from Human Rights Watch. I'm the UN director. Thanks very much for organizing this event, which we believe will really help improve the transparency of this election. I want to address a few questions to the ambassador from Kyrgyzstan. And ambassador, thanks very much for attending this meeting for the first time. We really appreciate your presence here. I have three short questions. First, there are two very concerning pending legislations in front of the parliament in Kyrgyzstan, one on foreign agents and one on so-called LGBT propaganda. So we are very concerned about these legislations, and I wanted to ask you what steps your government intends to take to ensure that when there is no discrimination on the basis of sexual orientation in your country, and two, to ensure freedom of association for all civil society organizations, including those that receive foreign funding. The second question I wanted to ask you is how you plan to address concerns about the wrongfully imprisoned human rights defender Azimiev Askarov. And the third one has to do with survivors of domestic violence in your country. Your country made important commitments on how to address this issue. In particular, we would like to know what steps your government will take to ensure access to critical support services like shelter or access to justice for survivors of domestic violence. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Sorry, the lady over there has the floor.
Amnesty International for organizing these events, as well as the co-sponsors. This is an excellent opportunity for a very useful dialogue with candidate countries. And Portugal fully, I'm sorry I didn't introduce myself, I'm DPR of Portugal. And Portugal fully supports this exercise, and last year we participated, fully committed, then in our quality as a candidate for the Human Rights Council. I have just a few general questions for all candidate countries, and as follows. So, do the candidates believe IHRC is doing all it can to prevent human rights violations, or in other words, is the IHRC doing enough to respond to pressing human rights crises? And how could the candidates, how could the candidates and the Human Rights Council better respond to the plight of migrants? This is a very pressing issue worldwide at the moment, and I would also like to hear from candidate countries how do they envisage the response of the Council in this regard. And what do the candidates think of the use of non-action motions in procedure, as a procedural tool to stop debates on specific topics? I thank you.
Thank you very much. And I think we had a question from just over here. Yeah.
Good morning. My name is Daniel Hamidi, and I am with the International Gay and Lesbian Human Rights Commission. My question for all the candidates is people across the globe on the basis of their real or perceived sexual orientation, gender identity, or gender expression.
Thank you very much. We're going to conclude this round with two questions from Twitter. One is directed to Belgium. How will Belgium address concerns in relation to its prison system, and specifically overcrowding and conditions for mentally ill patients? And we also have a question that has come from the United Arab Emirates, asking all candidates whether they allow human rights defenders to operate freely in their country without harassment and fear of reprisal. And with that, we will now return to the candidates for a first round of answers to those questions. And since we started with Belgium in the first round, we'll now start with the next one in alphabetical order, meaning that first up will be Georgia.
Well, as I to start with the first question was about women human rights, and I will link to that the other one about the human rights defenders, whether they operate freely in my country. The short answer would be yes, they do operate freely in my country, and there hasn't been any reprisals. In general, we are of course against any sort of reprisals to this, and I also want to recall the resolution 2424, where Georgia's position is in line with the position of the European Union, and my country as a member of the Council of Europe also abides itself with all the procedures and human rights norms that are within the organization. With regard to the women human rights, as I mentioned briefly in my opening statement, we have special assistant to the Prime Minister on gender equality issues, and that office also oversees the implementation of the resolution 1325 and all the other relevant resolutions. We also have the Gender Equality Council, yet another watchdog in terms of the rights of women. Georgia passed a comprehensive anti-discrimination law, which is against any kind of discrimination against in general, but the law also explicitly prohibits discrimination on the ground of gender identity, to respond to the question that was asked just recently. As for the non-action motion as a procedural tool, again, the answer would be very short, and the answer would be no. We do not like this, and we do not support this as a tool. We believe there should be an action, and subsequently the discussion, and hopefully the resolution. As for whether HRC can prevent human rights violations, the only thing that we can do, we can work on it and try to prevent. Monitoring the human rights situation is always an early warning of the possible worsening that could lead to even graver situation. So therefore, HRC has a potential. Of course, there is always a room for improvement. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Germany, you have the floor.
Yeah, thank you. First, on the question from a lady from India, first of all, let me mention that Germany was one of the co-sponsors of the resolution on women's human rights defenders, and we take this issue as a co-sponsor very, very seriously. The EU guidelines on human rights defenders also make very clear, and we follow them, that we instruct our embassies all over the world to give the necessary support in whatever way possible. And this is something we follow up on in the best possible manner. although I have to agree, you mentioned the forgotten conflict. This is something we also deplore, and we try not to be driven by the media. But what the phenomenon you described is a fact. We try to go against it, but you know how politics work, and it takes an active approach, and we try to follow up on this wherever it's possible. You ask about how we take up critical issues also. Well, we do that in all different manners, on all different levels, and we do it sometimes in the open public, but we also do it behind closed doors, whatever seems more appropriate to us. And I can assure you, also from my own experience, that wherever, especially our foreign minister travels, human rights issues are on the table and are being addressed in very candid terms. And this holds true for other members of our government as well, but also, of course, for our embassies all around the world. On the question from Portugal, well, you asked whether the Human Rights Council is doing enough, to put it bluntly. Well, no, I don't think so, because given the state of the world, there's always more we can do. And there are, I mean, so many crises on the table at the moment which we have to deal with, that it gets difficult for the Council sometimes to deal with everything in an appropriate and sufficient manner. Having said that, I would like to stress that we, for instance, took up addressing the Syria crisis with our resolution in the Human Rights Council, we addressed everything which was in our power in the Council in terms of human rights, but the Syria issue is something which is of great importance to us, and this directly brings me also to the issue of migration. I think, you're a colleague from the EU, you know what the EU has been doing. I think there is more that can be done in the Human Rights Council, and this issue will not go away, so this should be addressed, yes. Then you also ask about the no action motions. This is a practice which is possible under the statutes of the Human Rights Council. It is a valid instrument, but of course we think that debates have to take place, and it's a practice we sometimes deplore. We think that everything, we must be able to discuss everything openly and freely, and there certainly shouldn't be an abuse of instruments which are, I have to stress again, possible under the rules and regulations of the Human Rights Council. On LGBTI, well, I think our record there is also not bad. We come out wherever possible on LGBTI rights. We have projects in many countries, and also here in New York, we participate very actively in all LGBTI-related issues and events. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Kyrgyzstan, you have the floor.
Thank you for the question, the representative of Human Rights Watch. I would like just to answer by turn. Relating LGBT draft law, first of all, I would like to point out that according to our Constitution, no law or bylaw regulations could be adopted which restricts the basic rights and freedoms of human beings. The Constitution also prohibits any discrimination based on sex, religion, ethnicity, and other circumstances. Besides, according to our legislation, all laws relating to human rights issues should pass three readings in the Parliament, and the participation of the civil society in the discussion is obligatory. And the viewpoints, proposals, and initiatives of the civil society, as I have said before, we have a very strong civil society, should be taken into account. And besides the laws which cause some discussions, the parliament usually tries to take the independent expertise. That's why we had an expert revision from European Union, Council of Europe, and in this regard, the Parliament came to the conclusion to postpone the adoption of this law and to conduct further discussions. Second, relating to the law or international agents, basically relating to non-governmental organizations. As I have said, we have more than 10,000 non-governmental organizations which have been registered in the Ministry of Justice. And no organization should be also discriminated according to certain statutes if they correspond to the law. According to the general procedure relating to elaboration and adoption of the laws concerning human rights issues, we had also had several discussions, several readings in the Parliament, and taking into account the proposals of the civil society, the conclusions of legal experts, this law also was postponed for further consideration. Relating to the defender, human rights defender Azim Askarov, he was accused by the decision of the district law, district court, then regional court, and the Supreme Court confirmed the decisions of the courts of the first and second instances. He was accused of organizing mass riots, as you know, during June events in 2010, complicity in murder of the representative of law enforcement structures, and he was accused for life imprisonment. After that, upon the request of many human rights organizations, legal different entities, and some countries, we also allowed to have different meetings to get acquainted with all materials, evidence, testimonies, and the result was that the decision of the three courts were found just and fair. That's why I think there is no the issue on this problem. Relating to domestic violence, we have a special program against domestic violence, and quite recently Kyrgyzstan introduced additional amendments into the legislation increasing the punishment for domestic violence. Besides, we had a set of trainings with law enforcement structures recently, and as the main approach to solving the issues of domestic violence based on the national legislation, we created several, the so-called prophylactic public centers, which cover practically all the country, more than 500, which joining more than 11 representatives of public and non-governmental organizations, women councils, and we have also more than 500 youth organizations which are working against
Ambassador, excuse me, I would ask you to wrap up and reach the conclusion of your remarks.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, and my apologies for interrupting, but I am very conscious of the very tight schedule and getting through interaction with eight candidates. We now move to Panama, please. You have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. I would like to refer to two or three of the questions which we consider very important, starting with the violence against women. We have created a specialized prosecutor to try these crimes and to receive all the complaints. This has been working very efficiently in the recent years, especially in the last year, and the system for receiving the complaints has been cleared to be swift and effective. We have also created a National Institute of Women with the government, coordinated with the government, for standing and permanent dialogue on these items. There's also another feature which we consider very important is that several ONGs devoted to this area are being subsidized by the Panamanian government through the Ministry of Social Development. So we feel that especially the Ministry of Social Development is engaged presently in the preparing and promoting public awareness and orientation on this subject, and also preparing an integrated legislation to cover all items related to violence against women. With regard to the non-action motions, Panama has opposed it, and we definitely do not support it. I have been impressed by the intervention of the human rights defender from India, and this has given us a certain alert for the need for protective shields that should come out of the commission. I think that this is something that we should consider very deeply in order to prevent and not only to intervene when things are getting out of hand. That would be my intervention for the moment.
Thank you very much. Republic of Korea, you have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'll start to respond by the last question, the question with regard to the sexual orientation and gender identity. Korea fully shares the international community's conviction that there should be no discrimination based on the sexual orientation and gender identity. If you can see the Korea's track record as member of Human Rights Council or member of UN General Assembly, this year and last year, we participate in the joint statement. For example, this year, the last Human Rights Council, we participate on the joint statement of violence and discrimination based on sexual orientation and gender identity. So our track record clearly shows how much we are committed in preventing the discrimination based on the sexual orientation. And then concerning the question from Portugal, I think we cannot be too much critical of the performance of the Human Rights Council because it's just celebrating 10th anniversary. But, you know, we are fully share your concern that there is enough room for improvement. That's why we are wholeheartedly supporting the initiative by German Ambassador Chairman for Human Rights Council for his initiative to reform the Human Rights Council, you know, to make HRC more effective and efficient tool in promoting human rights. Concerning no action motion, if you see one more time our track record as a member of Human Rights Council, we voted always no for no action motion because Human Rights Council should be allowed to discuss any issues which is related to human rights issues. Concerning the women human defenders' rights, I think how much Korea is committed in promoting the women's rights. And then Korea is participating as one of the champion countries for the UK initiative about the prevention of sexual violence in conflict initiative. And recently, the UN General Assembly
passed a resolution designating the 19th of June of the, every year for the elimination of sexual violence in conflict. Korea participates in this initiative very, very actively and constructively. Actually, the designating the 19th of June as the elimination day for sexual violence is our proposal. So you can see how clearly Korea is committed to protecting women's rights. And then if there is any human rights violation issues on the globe, I think Korea strongly believes in the value of the country-specific human rights resolution. So if there is an issue, we can discuss, and then we'll judge based upon the internet community standard and our common understanding. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Slovenia.
Thank you. I will start from the beginning of the questions. So on the human rights defenders, and especially the women human rights defenders, of course there is a normative framework which also which is seen also in the GA resolution, and it was mentioned also by Germany. There is also the EU position and guidelines on the work on the human rights defenders, but still the what is missing is of course better implementation. And we believe that better understanding on the role of the human rights defender, especially women, which can be raised by education process that starts in schools. Regarding the frozen conflicts, of course there are many in the world, and it's in this particular issue we see special role of NGOs, of media, of civil society, trying to raise the awareness on these situations. We are having some of Slovene activists around the world who are trying to raise the awareness on particular conflicts, which could then influence the politicians both nationally and also in the international fora. Then just related questions from the United Arab Emirates on the human rights defenders. In Slovenia, they can act freely and without any fear of reprisals. On the question of Portugal, I believe that Human Rights Council, of course, is doing a lot, actually more and more, if we are seeing the number of discussions, number of resolutions, but regarding the situation in the world, as we see in the area of human rights, of course, it's never enough. And it's also linked to the lack of resources and capacity. So this is also one of the situations where there is not only lack of political will, but there is certainly lack of capacity. On the non-action motion, like the previous speaker has said, of course legally it's possible, but we would like to avoid any non-action motion and try to have the debate and try to have the decisions on any issue, because any discussion is better than none. And on the LGBTI, that also goes, it's important to stress that promotion of tolerance and respect starts at home and in schools. So it's also the human rights education is something which can bring us then to better tolerance in the society. There, of course, each country has to go through certain legislative improvements that are going on also in Slovenia, but we believe that education is the core for the really to have the gender-based society. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Switzerland, you have the floor.
Thank you very much. Given the time constraints and things, a lot have been said, what I wanted to say, I just want to align myself with what a colleague from Germany has said on human rights defenders and the Human Rights Council. That also, I think the remark from my colleague from Slovenia on the Human Rights Council, I think it's important that there's really also a lack of resources. And as we know, two-thirds of the Human Rights Council activities are financed by voluntary contributions. That's, from my point of view, a completely unacceptable situation. And we have supported, together with other 50 countries, a letter to the SG and also the member states calling for more resources for the Human Rights Council. And actually, the example shown by this intervention by India shows, you know, there are so many other situations which are forgotten, which we cannot address for several reasons, also for budgetary reasons. So I think that's another reason we should really work for a stronger council. On our action motion, I agree fully with others. We are not in favor of using that tool. That goes beyond explaining. On the issue of the refugees and the plight in the Mediterranean, I think that's a very good question by Portugal, a very actual one, and we feel that situation is really unacceptable. There is no easy solution to it. We have to accept that, probably. On the short run, I think we should also take a responsible and solidaric attitude to accepting refugees, and we will do that. We will take, for instance, 3,000 more from Syria over the next few years. But we need, I think, more and more a coordinated effort, and that is still lacking also in Europe, I have to say. So it's very difficult. On the long term, however, I think what we really need to be working on is the root causes, both the political one, human rights, but also economical ones. I think in that sense, I have some high hopes about the Rights Up Front initiative, which hopefully will streamline human rights more and create preventive capacities, so to avoid that in the future we have crises like that. Lastly, on the LGBT, of course, obviously, you know, there is no reason why you should discriminate people for reasons of gender or sex. But that is really quite obvious. We are focusing on that also in the whole question of women's empowerment, women's rights. So that is, from our point of view, an issue which we look into from our foreign policy perspective. But once again, we are strongly advocating no discrimination for reasons of gender or sex. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ambassador. And finally, Belgium.
Chair, five points as short as I can be, and I can't never be complete. There was one specific question for Belgium, which is overcrowding in Belgian prisons, which is a reality. I fully recognize that. Though at least last year we've had an improvement in the figures, but we're not there yet. I fully admit that. Part of the solution is to build more and better equipped prisons, but that can never be the whole solution. The marked improvement which we've had recently is mainly due to electronic surveillance, where people can stay at home and have electronic surveillance, which is a way to reintegrate them in society and in their families, which is a marked improvement on what we had in the past. There is also a review of penal practices, which in practice means that less people are condemned to stay in prisons. So overcrowding has been reduced. And then another specific question was about the mentally ill patients which were imprisoned. And there we have at least some improvement, because recently a specialized center has been opened which provides for these patients and which provides specialized care. But certainly we have to do more because the present capacity is not yet sufficient, and Belgian authorities are fully aware of that. Then on four more general points, accountability, the question which was asked by our colleague from India, I can only point out that for many of those difficult solutions, we have different instruments. There's UPR, there's discussions under item 5 of the agenda of the Council, there are resolutions on country situations, there are the action of special procedures, both thematic and country procedures. There are also briefings by the High Commissioners, so all those instruments are available, and we will always, for different situations, use one or more of these instruments. And I should also remind that in the end, it's true that the Human Rights Council remains also a forum for political dialogue. So this political dialogue is also part of the instruments which we have to look for improvement of human rights. Turning to non-action motions, as our Korean colleague, our Swiss colleague and others, we are fully committed to have a discussion and to take decisions on substance, and not to vote in favor of non-action motions. We will always vote against non-action motions. The plight of migrants, as others, we recognize there is a grave crisis. We want to do our share, both in action with a vessel which we have in the Mediterranean. in order to save lives, but of course more needs to be done. And the Council, in our view, has an important role in favoring a multidimensional approach, bringing together a number of instruments. And we believe that the last session has been a good session in that respect, but more should be done. On a national basis, we are fully committed to the application of the 1951 Convention on Refugees. And of course, as others, we believe that we should act in order to fight the root causes of this refugee crisis. Finally, to conclude, LGBTI, on a national basis, we have made quite some progress, but we're not there yet. We are now, right now, in the process of preparing a second national action plan on these questions. Within the Council, I would say that objectively, over the past decade, the Council has made progress and a number of decisions were taken. And what I find most important is that there is a willingness and an ability to continue the constructive dialogue on these issues with all member states. So on that one, I believe we have made progress and we shall work in order to continue this in a spirit of constructive dialogue. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. We'll now move to a second round of questions from the audience. And again, I'd remind everyone, please, to be concise and also to identify yourself. Thank you, the gentleman over there.
Hello, I'm Joshua Cooper from the Hawaii Institute for Human Rights. It's an honor to be here today and participate. First question I'd like to hear about is the commitment to the human rights of Indigenous peoples by all the candidates, specifically the Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples and the World Conference outcome document. And the second point is, it's a very refreshing session. It's great to see the exchange of ideas and information. Could states share why there's only 8 states participating, how we can involve and include more candidates in the future? And a final specific question to Switzerland was, explain the difference between the Paris Principles and the Swiss Center for Human Rights Expertise. Very interested in that model. Thank you.
Thank you for those admirably concise questions.
Thank you. I'm representing the Permanent Mission of Eritrea. I would like to thank the organizers of this event and the participants for the important discussion. My question is to the potentially new members of the Human Rights Council and the candidates. How do you plan on addressing the politicization of human rights in the Human Rights Council, which in our view seems to be growing? And my second question is, how can you address and strengthen the promotion and protection of human rights through the principle of genuine dialogue as well as cooperation? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next question. Over there at the back on this side. Yes, madam, madam over there, the floor is yours. Could you perhaps get yourself to a working microphone?
Thank you very much, and I thank Amnesty and also the permanent missions in New York, Brazil, Botswana, Netherlands for having such an important meeting. I'm from a permanent mission of Iran, and I listened carefully to the question and also comments and pledges made by distinguished ambassadors and representative here, and also a question raised by different organizations, NGOs on this matter. And My question, first question was in similar line with my colleague from Eritrea, which I share her views on this matter and our expectation from members of the council, new potential members. And second question is again issue of migrants, and I appreciate distinguished ambassador of Switzerland and distinguished representative of Belgium for very their valuable comments on this responding to this issue of migrants, but still we have a question with respect to the distinguished representative of Germany on the issue of which they are also running again for membership of the Human Rights Council. And it is the issue of increased number of violent expression and hate crimes against asylum seekers. This is a reality. And also the anti-migrant protest, which is based on the reports, Human Rights Watch reports, they are or different organizations increasing. So our question is that, is there any specific plan or commitment by Germany, the government of Germany, who wants to join again to Human Rights Council to overcome this issue, which is not only covers the Mediterranean issue of migrants, but also inside some society of the European community. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We're just going to take a couple of Twitter questions and then a couple more from the room. The first is, how are candidates respecting the right to privacy against unlawful surveillance? And the second relates to child rapes in the Central African Republic. And the question is on what the questioner characterizes as OHCHR's cover-up of child rapes in the Central African Republic. What is the Human Rights Council's oversight role? And now we'll just look for a couple more questions I think we had from the room. Perhaps you could raise your hands just so that I can see where you are. Yes, Chile.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator, and thank you to the organizers, Brazil, Botswana, and the Netherlands, for this very useful session. I would like to express a recognition to the candidates, you know, to submit themselves to this practice that really think allow us useful exchanges and should strengthen their candidatures. Chile firmly believes that dialogue and cooperation are the key elements, tools, and approach when dealing with human rights at the Council and everywhere, also as the principle of universality and non-discrimination when speaking of human rights. I feel very encouraged by some development that we have heard from some of the candidates, you know, information we didn't have before. And in this context, I need to mention an initiative by Chile, Brazil, Colombia, and Uruguay at the Human Rights Council 29th session of a joint statement dealing with violence and discrimination against people based on sexual orientation and gender identity. This statement is still open for the signature. It has been done so by 27 states. I should say that not all the candidates have joined it, and I really think that it should send a signal very powerful that they are really committed to non-discrimination, non-stigmatization on any ground of anyone, including of persons of different sexual orientation and gender identity. So, but I would like also, particularly by those who may not have signed yet, to tell us, you know, to share with us how could we better assist them in tackling these issues. This is the reality. You know, we recognize in Chile, starting with, you know, that these are sensitive issues for our societies. We have not resolved everything, so we are aware of that. But we are ready also, by doing this kind of a statement, you know, that rejects violence and discrimination, to help and assist others, you know, and to deal, provide capacity building or whatever is needed, you know, to really share this concern and this campaign. I really encourage the members who have not done so, the candidates, to join this statement, which is still available in Geneva. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Last couple of questions. Okay.
Thanks, Mr. Chair. My name is Amjad. I'm from Permanent Mission of Yemen to the UN. Actually, I'd like to thank you for organizing this event, and to all candidates, I'd like to ask how they could address the humanitarian, the catastrophic humanitarian situation back home in Yemen, which affect all aspects of lives for the people back home, even civilians, girls, older people, youth, women, every life, every aspect of the life back home. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We have a gentleman at the back there.
Thanks a lot. Sorry. Matthew Lee, Inner City Press. I heard Ambassador Seeger of Switzerland mention this rights, the rights up front, which at least to my understanding came out of the UN's seeming failure in Sri Lanka to take action in 2009. So I wanted to know the candidates that are running. The Human Rights Council decided to defer that report. It was due in March. They decided to defer it. Many people saw it as sort of a political decision to defer it. What would they have done, and what do they think should be done? Should there be political considerations in delaying reports? And also to South Korea or Republic of Korea, I know that there's some freedom of the press issues. There was a journalist that was deported or told he couldn't leave, then forced to leave for writing about the president. There's also, it seems that for journalists, it can be illegal to report positively on Democratic People's Republic of Korea, which is obviously on the agenda of the Human Rights Council. So I wonder, how does this jibe with running for the council in terms of the freedom of journalists, and if the other candidates want to speak to the place of freedom of the press in their candidacy for the council? Thanks.
Thank you very much. At the back there in the corner.
Yes, thank you, Chair. I'm Max Andersson with Access, which is a global organization that defends and extends digital rights of users at risk around the world. And I would like to quickly thank the organizers and the candidate countries for attending. Very happy also and very appropriately that the Twitter question that came in was had to do with how to combat unlawful government surveillance and to protect the right to privacy. Very briefly, my question then is directed at Germany, which certainly has played an important role in the UN context when it comes to the right to privacy in the digital age. And so do they view the Human Rights Council as the correct venue for a continued discussion, or is there still space for the General Assembly to continue its work, its successful work, which it has done in the last two sessions? Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And I have still one request for the floor from Denmark.
Thank you very much. I'm Julie Kofod from the Permanent Mission of Denmark. First of all, I wanted to congratulate all the candidates for participating in the meeting today. I think it's a great sign of willingness to engage in human rights questions and openness, which is really duly noted. My question is on the fight against torture, and I'm very pleased to see that actually all eight candidates who are present here today have all ratified the Convention Against Torture. Most of them has also ratified the optional protocol to the Convention Against Torture. However, two countries, one Belgium, have only signed, not ratified, and Republic of Korea has neither signed nor ratified. So my question is specifically to those two countries, if there are any anything going on with regards to ratifying this optional protocol to the Convention Against Torture. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And before we close the floor, is there any final request? I have to pick one, sorry, at random. This in the middle there.
Thank you. I'm Katie Mayall from the Center for Reproductive Rights, and I was hoping that the candidates could speak to how they believe that reproductive rights could be further advanced within the Council.
Thank you very much. That is quite a lot of meaty questions. We have eight candidates now to provide responses. If we can, if possible, restrict responses to two maximum, absolute maximum 3 minutes, then we will be able to complete this round. Thank you. Now we're going to jump one candidate further in our alphabetical order, which means we'll now be starting with Germany. You have the floor.
Now I wonder how I should possibly do that. But I can answer to a few questions, and in particular to those in which I was addressed as in my national capacity. But let me first of all say on indigenous people is something which we care about a lot. When, as most people probably know, we do not have an indigenous population in Germany ourselves, but we are very active in this field, and we have a great number of projects run by our Ministry of Economic Cooperation. And we are also we have always been a very strong supporter of including indigenous people's rights in the post-2015 agenda. On the two questions, or the one question which was asked by Eritrea and Iran about dialogue and cooperation, of course, I mean, as a diplomat, I'm always in favor of dialogue. That's what we should never stop. We should always talk to each other, try to find solutions by talking to each other. But on the other hand, we are, of course, also very strong supporters of the idea that the Human Rights Council can, in fact, express itself on grave human rights violations, and there must be the instruments of country-specific resolutions, and we are also, of course, in favor of the instrument of commissions of inquiry. Iran has asked the questions, a question first of all about migrants. Let me just add to what my colleagues from Switzerland and Belgium have already said. This is unacceptable, the situations of migrants in the Mediterranean, and first of all, we have to care about the people who are on their way, so that's what we're doing with two vessels in the Mediterranean, with now a few thousand people which have actually been rescued by those two vessels. Let me also say, and this leads to the second question about asylum seekers in Germany, we have up to now taken 120,000 Syrians in Germany, and until the end of this year, this number will go up to 200,000, so this is the largest country in Europe. Of course, the countries in the region have to bear the heaviest burden, but of all other countries who are not neighboring countries, Germany has taken the largest number of Syrian refugees. And this is something, and there I come to the question, which has large support in the German population. So there is even a growing consensus that we also have to take our responsibility in dealing with the refugee crisis. This is one part of our answer. Then let me say that we are very much aware that we still have a problem in Germany with xenophobia, racism, other expressions of exclusion. So this is something we take very, very seriously. But we are also in the process of taking concrete action on this. We already have action plans for a few years now. We have a number of institutions who are dealing with that. And I would like to stress that there have been large-scale demonstrations in Germany after recent attacks on asylum seekers' homes, a fact which the attacks we highly deplore, but it's also a fact that in the German society as a whole is strongly opposed to all those occurrences. The second question I was asked is, do we think that there should be a role for the General Assembly when it comes to privacy? Well, we have now started the process at the Human Rights Council. We have just named the special rapporteur, and we are looking forward to his work and his findings. Having said that, of course, at some point there will be the moment when this will revert in one form or the other to the General Assembly.
Thank you very much. To Kyrgyzstan now.
There were some questions relating why there are, I don't remember who put this question, only 8 states are participating today in this event. I think it's a very good practice, especially for those countries who have put its candidature for the first time to Human Rights Council. It gives the possibility to show the commitment of the countries who are going to Human Rights Councils and the responsibility which they would implement in the future. And in this regard, I would like just to propose that maybe it will be important to have periodically these events here in New York and once in Geneva, because the main experts are working in our missions in Geneva, and the mission of Geneva is participating in the work of Human Rights Council. Then there was a question of relating to migration issue. Kyrgyzstan is paying special attention as a migrating sending country. Today, within economic crisis and unemployment, the most important thing is labor migration. And the recent analysis and the investigations in our region showed that the basic problem is forced labor, which are many labor migrants are facing today. In this regard, to our mind, is the best way to promote and protect the human rights of labor migrants is that all the countries join the Convention on Protection of the Rights of Labor Migrants and Their Families, and the system of bilateral and regional agreements on the protection of human rights of labor migrants, their social protection, and especially preventing from forced labor. There was a question on relating from Yemen. I think it's a really serious problem which should be permanently on the agenda of Human Rights Council, and the effective work of OCHA as well as the Peace Building Fund should be brought to the agenda. Kyrgyzstan also had good experience after the events in 2010 when we had several programs with Peace Building Fund and OCHA, which helped us to stabilize in several days the situation in Kyrgyzstan, and now having peace and stability and passing to sustainable development. There was also the question of how to promote the dialogue within Human Rights Council. I think what is important is that all countries, first of all, should have political will to cooperate in the spheres of protection of human rights. Secondly, of course, we need certain resources to solve the problems which are on the especially global and regional agenda. And of course, we should take into account cultural, traditional specifics of the countries, and especially those countries who are in the most vulnerable position and very often have no necessary resources to solve the problems of protection and promotion of human rights. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Panama, you have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. I would like to start to explain a few things about the indigenous people, their rights, and how it works in my country, which is a similar situation to other Latin American countries, especially in the area of Central America and north of South America. With regards to Panama, we have devoted great attention to the situation of the indigenous people, something that hasn't been very easy. It's not simple at all, because we're dealing with a very specific culture, very specific beliefs, and a lot of our Western type civilizations do not understand the very deeply rooted beliefs that these people have. So in Panama, we have turned to the dialogue and to the attempt to educate the indigenous people on the need for accessing the benefits of civilization to them and the basic needs that have to be solved. It's, like I said, it's not a simple matter, but in order to address it properly, the Panamanian government has instituted a vice minister specialized in this area. Now, just to give a general idea of what the indigenous people represent in Panama, they're 12% of the population, and 28% of our territory has been assigned to different ethnias as common property. Now, within those common properties, they have, like I said, their own cultural beliefs and their own regimen, I would say their own legal systems, which are more or less in accord with the legal system of the country. However, they are respected so long as they don't go against the Constitution of the Republic, and they have been very, I would say, very agreeable with this situation. The dialogue has been the best instrument that has been used by the Panamanian government in situations of crisis, except, unfortunately, in about 4 or 5 years ago, that we had very serious incidents with indigenous people that were against some development of hydroelectric plants in their territory. Actually, it wasn't their territory, but they felt that it affected their own land. This is still under discussion. There's been an ongoing dialogue in which even the President of the Republic has been involved. He has been to the areas dialoguing with the different groups to see if there's an understanding finally of what the needs of the country are and how much they feel that their land is going to be affected. Parallel to this, the government has assigned a huge amount of funds for development of those areas. Now, developing those areas is a difficult item also. They are sparsely located, distant one village from another, and on top of that, they have a different type of economic situation. They are seasonal workers. They go and they work when there's a harvest of coffee or plantain or something like that. And after the harvest is finished, they have no work to do, and their land is generally not fit for massive production. So those are situations that are very difficult, but the government has pinpointed places where this investment can begin in order to start evolving into something which is more close to respecting their human rights. With regards to the right to privacy, we have had also, we still have some scars, a violation to the right of privacy in our country, and the best way to fight it so far has been to strengthen the legal institutions that have access to those violations, and we have been improving this greatly. I think that at present there is no real violation of the right to privacy except under judicial orders, which is the way it should be. With regards to dialogue on human rights, like I said, it's an ongoing thing with all the ONGs and the government institutions that have been created in Panama. And it's been very successful, and the civil society is very active and is very much participating in the new evolution of our
judicial institutions.
Excuse me, Ambassador, if I may just ask if you could try to wrap up your remarks. Take a few more seconds if you would like, but if you could work to the end. If you want to say a last thing.
The last point was that we support the resolution on the issue of child rape. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Republic of Korea.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Concerning the indigenous people's right, the Korea used to be a very monocultural society. We are becoming very multicultural in a rapid way. So it's a slightly different issue, but there used to be some mishandling of this new phenomenon in Korea, but we are very rapidly catching up with the mechanisms in place to deal with this issue of the rapidly growing the multicultural the problems. Concerning the value of the dialogue and cooperation at the Human Rights Council, as I mentioned at the first round of the answers, we believe in the resolutions at the Human Rights Council, including the country-specific resolutions. If there is really genuine and strong will to engage in the dialogue and cooperation from all stakeholders, I think we should proceed in that way. We should engage in cooperation and dialogue. I think that that's the Sri Lankan case is the point the case in point, I think, because for now, for Sri Lanka, it is worthwhile to giving them some time to getting through their democratization process, and we'll take a more closer look at the upcoming session at the Human Rights Council to examine how seriously they are taking necessary measures. Concerning the right to privacy and illegal supervising, I think Korea is guaranteeing same level of the protection to those rights on those freedom online, equally compared with the freedom of expression offline. And then concerning the sexual orientation and gender inequality, I already answered at the first round. And then concerning the questions about the freedom of expression in Korea, my country is fully respecting the freedom of expression, and then we are one of the co-sponsor countries for the freedom of expression resolution at the UN Human Rights Council. Domestically speaking, when there is deformation and infringing the rights of other people, or there is the direct threat to our national security or public order, in this case, exceptionally, we are giving some restraint in exercising the right of expression. I think my colleague from the Inner City Press mentioned one journalist case in Korea. In the case, there is some the legal filing from civil society, and then our judiciary branch of the government, our court, they made their own judgment, and that clearly violates our code about the freedom of expression. So the judiciary process has been guaranteed, and then the according to the public opinion, the one-sidedly, there is some consensus about that. Even the public opinion, and then concerning he mentions also the some question about our national security law. The country still divided, and then getting the real military threat on a daily basis coming from the north. We have the national security law still in place, but that has been revised several times, and then it's been applicated in an exceptional basis, only when there is a direct threat to our national security, and at the same time we are taking very serious look whether it can inflict the freedom of expression or freedom of any kind of freedom of our citizen. And then the question from Denmark about Korea's accession to the optional protocol of the Convention on the Torture, and then I wish to refer all of you to our voluntary pledges and commitment. In our pledges and commitment, we already mentioned that examining the possibility of accession to the optional protocol. And so we are considering the acceding to this optional protocol. You know, at the first round of at my opening statement, I mentioned that we signed the convention against the organized transnational organized crime, but it took 13 years for Korea to revise one or two articles of our criminal code, and it took two more years to finally be ratified by National Assembly just 2 months ago. So it took 15 years for Korea from signing to ratifying, because having the tradition of the continental law, we see very seriously all domestic regulations should be fitting with the international norms and regulations. That's why it takes time, but as we pledge it, as per our pledge, we are seriously taking the issue. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Slovenia.
Thank you. I'll start with the question of the human rights of indigenous people, and I think that this is also an example that Slovenia really pays attention to all human rights of all people. Since we don't have the indigenous population in Slovenia, we are trying to work in the international fora also in this regard to better respect their rights. Therefore, last September, the permanent representative of Slovenia was one of the advisors to the then PGA for preparation of successfully adopted outcome document of the World Conference. Then on the promotion of dialogue and of course, in ideal world, the solutions to any conflicts would be based on dialogue and mutual understanding. And since this is not the case, the UN and especially Human Rights Council need to address the situation regarding the human rights violations. And I believe that the best way to avoid so-called politicization of any cases would be, of course, that all countries would do their best to promote and respect the human rights of their population. But this is, again, the ideal scenario. Then on right to privacy, Slovenia very appreciates and supports the initiative by Germany and Brazil. And we believe that also Human Rights Council should deal with the issue. We are having our national bodies and legislation that is trying to prevent the breaches in this regard. But since we are living in the interconnected world, of course, none of the countries can do it alone. We are trying to do to improve the protection in the European Union, but of course it's the wider problem. Then there was also one question on the from Twitter on the child rapes in Central African Republic. We believe that Human Rights Council should discuss any accusations of the severe abuses of human rights, and of course try to find the ways to address the situation, of course, see the evidence, and of course, try to see how the things could become better. And there was also on Yemen and the humanitarian situation in Yemen. Of course, we are concerned about the situation in the country, and since there is the primary responsibility for the peace and security in the country, so on the Security Council, but still Human Rights Council should discuss the situation of the human rights in the country, but just to improve only the humanitarian situation. The Human Rights Council as such is not really the proper body. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Switzerland, you have the floor.
Thanks a lot. I think I only have 2 minutes. I apologize that my responses will only be one-liners. How to address the politicization of the Human Rights Council? I think there is no easy answer, but we see a fact-based, law-based discussion on non-selectivity as probably the best possibilities to address the risk of politicization. On genuine dialogue, I think we favor very much
bilateral dialogue with a number of countries, even in situations where we disagree on the human rights, on the track record. So I think that's, from my point of view, a quite useful line. And also, I think the UPR is also a form of dialogue, which I think is very important to maintain. On Paris, the Paris principles, what's the difference between our setup and the Paris principles? Well, there's basically two. The Paris principles require a legislative text for the institution. We don't have that, for the time being at least. And it should also take up individual complaints, which our mechanism cannot do, at least for the time being. The reason is basically that people argue the institutional mechanism in Switzerland are quite highly developed. Everybody can make a complaint on human rights violations to anybody at court, at institutions, and therefore the value added of another mechanism is the issue which we discuss right now. On right to privacy, I agree with much what my colleague from Slovenia has said. It's for us very much a priority. On the child rapes in Central African Republic, well, I think that issue harmed the United Nations and also the OHCR quite a lot. And I think we are happy that there is this independent panel which has now been established, and we look forward to see its work. And then based on the results, we have to discuss on which fora we should address that situation and what kind of conclusions should we take. I wouldn't exclude that we also discuss in the Human Rights Council, but let's look at the report first. On Sri Lanka, delaying the report, well, my view is that this has not been one of the strongest moments of the Human Rights Council, but I think the situation in Sri Lanka has improved with the new government. There is hope that things are looking up now, so we should hopefully take a positive approach towards the future. And last not least, because my time is running out, on reproductive rights, obviously every woman should have ownership and autonomy over her reproductive rights. That's one thing we have been advocating very strongly in the past and continue to do so in the future. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Belgium, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Chair. I'll respond in some detail to the specific question asked by Denmark, and then for the course of brevity, we'll be very brief on others. Belgium has the commitment to sign and ratify as soon as possible UPCAT, but we have some, let's say that we take quite some time to create, according to the principles the Paris principles, our national human rights institution. We have been negotiating for some time, and this is linked to our ambition to have all Belgian regions, which have a very important role in our federal country, involved in that institute. Indeed, for the citizen, it's important to have one single institute. It's not for the citizen to decide who decides what, but if he has any problems, he should be able to go to one single institution. I can tell you that our government now is edging close to the creation of such an institution. Our Minister of Justice has only a few weeks ago repeated his ambition and his commitment to create such an institution according to the Paris principles during the present mandate of the government. And at that stage, we can immediately sign and ratify and apply UPCAT. I also remind that in the framework of the Council of Europe, we regularly receive the European Committee for the Prevention of Torture. So on substance, certainly, we are committed to this instrument. Then on a few of the other more general questions, there was the call for to come back from what some call a growing politicization. I tend to talk about polarization, and as I believe the Swiss ambassador said, if we have a objective and facts-based dialogue, that would certainly help. And in that respect, I remind all member countries the need to receive the visit of special procedures. If based on their reports we can have a discussion, it certainly helps us to avoid some polarization. And unfortunately, there's still too many countries which have a large number of outstanding requests, not only from country-based special procedures, but also from thematic special procedures. Right to privacy, we were very much convinced about the need to have a special rapporteur, there again to have a fact-based dialogue because the principles remain the same on privacy, but we know that technological change means that we have increasing problems. And so there we look forward to have a dialogue based on the inputs, among others, of the special rapporteur. Finally, on child rape, I can only remind that in our pledges we also mention the fact that we have a second national action plan on women, peace and security, and in that framework one of the main priorities both in our internal action and in our external action is the protection of women and girls from all forms of violence, including sexual violence. So this is a priority, and in our action both in the Council and here in the United Nations, we much call on the United Nations and on troop contributing countries to cooperate in order to find a solution for the protection of all. I have an answer to all, but I think we don't really have time. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I wish we did have more time. Finally, Georgie, you have the floor.
Start with the data protection, because this is indeed a cross-cutting issue. We live in an internet age after all, and it's not related to specific cases only. My country has passed a personal data protection law and even has a data protection supervisory authority, an inspector which is elected by the parliament for the term of 3 years. But what is most important, what actually you do apart from legislation, is that what we do is that a special commission was set up to destroy the materials collected through the covert surveillance activities in previous years. So that's, and it is under supervision of a wider society and quite active participation of non-government organizations in it. With regard to freedom of expression, of course, it's guaranteed by the Constitution, but yet again, what country does, apart from what's stipulated in the law, criminal code of Georgia contains a number of provisions aimed at promotion, safety, and proper functioning of journalists. And there is also an obligation not only not to impede in the work of the journalists, but how to help the work of the journalists. It's provided in the law of Georgia on assembles and demonstrations, and in the general administrative code of Georgia that establishes special provisions on how public should respond to any question that comes from journalists. In general, we're also working on the Freedom of Information Act, the renewal of it, which will be adopted later this year. Of course, particular concern for us globally is the protection of journalists in conflict situations, because that's where we need an objective reporting, and unfortunately we have seen on numerous occasions when journalists were intimidated. Our track record and our participation in these in respective activities, be it here in New York or in Geneva, shows that quite well. And as for the safety of journalists, the resolution in Geneva, we are co-sponsors of that. Chile had about the joint statement on the violence and discrimination based on sexual orientation and gender identity. Georgia is part of that joint statement among 27 other countries. And with regard to torture, again, Georgia is a member of the Group of Friends on Convention Against Torture. With regard to rights of indigenous people, we are a small country. We are indigenous people ourselves in our country. We don't have any other indigenous people, but in general, we support the spirit, because rights of all people have to be protected, and there goes with the indigenous people as well. With regard to reproductive rights, indeed a woman has the right on reproduction, and my country has hosted during the last General Assembly and the previous one side events on this issue. And finally, about the politicization of human rights, well, unfortunately we do see that trend happening. Unfortunately, everything is about politics in this organization, but my country is a small country, and as a small country, we always stand for the principles, because our firm belief is that the only thing that can protect small countries is standing by the principles and by the charter, the UN charter, and the fundamental document. Therefore, you can rest assured that my country will do its fair share to protect the principles and the charter.
Thank you very much. And we're now approaching the end of the session. But as foreseen, there is an opportunity for candidates to make a very brief closing statement, which was originally foreseen as a one-minute statement. And I just would, looking at my watch, ask that everyone treat it as more of a New York minute than a UN minute, and ask, starting with Kyrgyzstan, to make your closing statement, please.
Thank you. First of all, I would like to thank all the participants of today's event. I think it was useful and very fruitful. We all well know that without promotion and protection of human rights, it's impossible to move forward, to reach sustainable development. In this regard, I think Human Rights Council plays a fundamental role. But the basic responsibility should be on the national countries, national governments. That's why we should do our utmost to promote and protect human rights at the national level, taking new legislation, introducing new institutions, and effectively cooperating with civil society. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Panama, you have the floor.
Thank you. This has been a very, very fruitful experience. I certainly agree with our colleague from Kyrgyzstan. And the candidates, all candidates that are present here, have agreed on the basics that we are called to represent. And with regard to Panama, we have re-emerged, like I said before, from very difficult human rights situations, and we have embraced them officially with all our hearts and with all our efforts, politically and socially and economically. One of the things that has been very helpful in promoting human rights in our country has come from the private sector. We have an economic social responsibility organization which has assisted the government in promoting everything that has to do with human rights. Finally, to have a New York minute, our candidature to the Human Rights Council is absolutely consistent with our conviction that this institution represents our values and we are promoting its universality. I think that what we have done so far is very much in line with the spirit of the Human Rights Commission, and we expect to be, as we have been so far, defenders, very conspicuous defenders of human rights, and we support special procedures, which is something that I left out before, and we agree with the need for quick reactions, and will work in the council, in the commission, to reinforce the objectives. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ambassador. Republic of Korea.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Korea has gone far away, not only in making economic development, but also making our country. Democratized fully and then very advanced in protecting human rights in a very short span of time. So as such, I think Korea is one of the countries which is best qualified to play a facilitating role or bridging role at the Human Rights Council. So if elected one more time, Korea will do its utmost to in playing a due role within the Human Rights Council, and thus contributing to the actual promotion and protecting of human rights. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Slovenia.
Thank you. I would also like to thank for this opportunity today to present our candidature and commitment to improve the protection and promotion of human rights at home and abroad. Slovenia is looking forward to further strengthening its work in the Human Rights Council and its cooperation with Council members as well as with all UN member states, NGOs, and civil society in order to continue contributing to this important mandate entrusted to the Council. We see the role of the Human Rights Council as essential in strengthening the international human rights architecture, shedding light on persistent and pressing human rights violations, and assisting states in improving their human rights records. We would like to contribute again to the work of the Council as its member in the 2016-2018 term. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Switzerland.
Well, I haven't prepared a statement. I just want to maybe end up on a personal note. When I was back in Bern 2008, one of my first meetings was participate in the first UPR. Now I'm closing my term here in New York. Actually, my wife is with the movers as we speak. And I'm once again talking about the Human Rights Council, so it's for me a privilege to have been working together with you and others in these issues. I think what is for us important is that we maintain a strong Human Rights Council, a strong independent Human Rights Council. It is a little bit of a brainchild of Switzerland. We have been contributing very strongly to it, and it's no coincidence that the Council is in Geneva. So my hope is, as I leave and go to Myanmar, where we also have human rights issues to discuss, that we are able to contribute to a strong Council in the future. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Belgium.
And I hope in my statements I have made clear our commitment to dialogue, to cross-regional engagement, to cross-fertilization also with other regional organizations in the, for example, there's the Inter-American system, the African Union, ASEAN, and others. But I want to end on one specific note. As my Swiss colleague, we are very much committed to a strong Human Rights Council, and I believe that the role of NGOs there, this dialogue proves it, is essential. They bring a fresh breath, they bring the experiences from the field, and in that respect we believe that we cannot have what we've had a number of incidents recently. We cannot have reprisals against human rights defenders who come to Geneva and who come to, you know, talk to us about the realities in the field. This will be one of our concerns during the coming months, at least if we get elected on this council. Thank you.
Thank you. Georgia.
Thank you very much. I want to thank you for moderating, and also want to thank the sponsors for organizing this this event. Georgia is always mindful of every decision that it makes with regard to any election. After all, we are not just a small country, but being a small country also means small number in terms of resources, including the human resources. But whenever we make this decision, again, as I said, we're very mindful, and we're never there just to warm the seat, but to contribute. And we have a track record of good contribution in particularly in the issues of human rights in CEDAW, in the Human Rights Committee and Committee Against Torture, where of course Georgian nationals were elected in their individual capacity, but we country proposed them, drawing on the pool of experts that we have in our society. Let me also mention that from the next General Assembly, my country will also be in the third committee as one of the vice chairs. Our pledges have been published in accordance with the resolution 60/251, and the brochures are also available on a display there to take away with you. Thank you.
Thank you, Ambassador. And the final closing statement from Germany.
Thank you. Before my minute starts, let me just say, unfortunately, we have not been able to answer all the questions, but we are very happy to answer everything which we were not able to respond to bilaterally. If ever anybody has an interest, we are ready, we stand ready to reply to all the questions that we are being asked. And I may add that while we were sitting here, my team has already answered to quite a number of questions on Twitter as well. Let me say, on a more serious note, right at the beginning of the German Constitution, in the very first article, in fact, it is stated that human rights shall be inviolable, and that human rights are the basis of every community and of peace and justice in the world. For us, this is a lesson from history. For us, human rights are universal, inalienable, and indivisible. As a founding member of the Human Rights Council, Germany has always strongly supported the Council's work as the centerpiece of the UN's human rights architecture. And of course, we are very proud that our ambassador to the Human Rights Council in Geneva currently holds the presidency of the Council. And we are very grateful for the trust that the members of the Council have placed in him. So Germany stands ready to take on responsibility again in order to further strengthen the Council in its role to promote and protect human rights worldwide. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That concludes our discussion. Let me please commend all the candidate countries who've come here to take part today and express the hope that next year we may get all of the candidate countries to come and enjoy this discussion. I hope that it's helped everyone here gain a better understanding of the vision and the priorities that these countries hope to bring to the Human Rights Council. As always, pledges come first and proof comes later. And in this case, the proof, I think, will come in a few years down the track when these countries complete their terms on the Human Rights Council. And at that point, I think we'll be able to see the extent to which the hopes and the commitments that have been expressed in this room have been matched by what unfolds over the next few years. And that perhaps is a subject for future engagement. But for now, a warm thank you to our candidates, to our co-hosts, and to everyone here and everyone watching online. Thank you.